Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. In the last class, we are discussing about how to select a microcontroller for a given task. Prior to that, we have discussed how to interface external RAM and ROM to 8051 if required. And in that example, we have discussed that basically we need number of address lines required for interfacing a particular amount of memory, whether it is RAM or ROM. So whether it is 4K or 8K or 16K or 32K, so using equation 2 to the power of n, we will be finding out the number of address lines required for interfacing the memory to 8051. Then after that, we will be finding out the starting address and end address. Obviously, in some cases, starting address will be given. If not given, then default starting address will be 0000. And then we'll be finding out the end address also. And then we also discussed the interfacing of RAM and ROM to 8051. And with respect to how to select a microcontroller for a given task, we have discussed so many parameters. Let us quickly review them. So first and foremost, selection criteria is the number of bits microcontroller we may require for a particular task. So as we know, there are three types of microcontrollers, that is 8-bit, 16-bit and 32-bits. And depending on the task, we will be either selecting a 8-bit microcontroller like 8051 or a 16-bit or a 32-bit microcontroller. Then obviously the second type of selection criteria is the family of a microcontroller. As we know that basically Intel has manufactured 8051 microcontroller, but later on many companies came into picture and they have also fabricate the or manufacture the microcontroller. So there are different families are there. For example, there is a AVR family, there is ARM family, there is a PIC microcontroller family. So each one has got its own advantages and then the disadvantages. Again, it basically boils down to the task which you want to complete. So second selection criteria is the family. So briefly, we have discussed what AVR family microcontroller gives and what PIC microcontroller gives. So looking into all these parameters, we need to select a particular type of microcontroller. Then one more selection criteria we have discussed is the type of architecture a particular microcontroller have. There are two types of architecture. One is known as what Princeton architecture. The second one is known as what Harvard architecture. Princeton architecture is also known as what von Neumann architecture. Again, if you are comparing Princeton and then the Harvard Harvard architecture, Harvard architecture is more faster, so it takes lesser amount of time to execute the instructions. So in most of the cases, for a task where speed matters, then we need to select a Harvard architecture. The one more parameter of selecting a particular microcontroller is the type of instruction set we have. So all the microcontrollers will be having either a RISC type of instruction set or CISC. As RISC stands for reduced instruction set, so we'll be having around 100 instructions or less than 100 instructions, whereas CISC stands for complex instruction set, where we'll be having more than 150 instructions. So again, we need to look into what basically we are looking for, and then we need to select either RISC or CISC. Then one more parameter is what whether we are looking for on-chip memory and or off-chip memory. Most of the microcontrollers comes with on-chip memory. Again, the amount of memory depends on type of microcontroller. Some may be having 4 kilobytes, some may be having 8 kilobytes. So if you have a on-chip memory, it is well and good. If you want some additional memory, then we need to interface it. If you have a microcontroller wherein we don't have a on-chip memory, then we need to interface it. So either on-chip memory or off-chip memory, we need to look into these things also. Then one more selection criteria is the package of IC. There are different types of packages in which the microcontroller comes, like DIP, SIP, SOP, QFP, PGA, BGA, and TQFP. But in most of the cases, Dulin package type of ICs are used for embedded applications, wherein basically microcontroller is used. Then one more important aspect is the integrated development environment, that is the software. So there are again various types of softwares are there which can be used in a microcontroller. So again, for looking the IDE, that we have a different components, like there is a editor, there is a compiler, there is a debugger, there is a linker, there is an interpreter, there is a hex file converter. So we need to look into all these aspects, and then we need to select that particular IDE. As we are discussed in the last class, in most of the cases Keel is used. So this is an again one of the important aspect of selecting a particular type of microcontroller. Then briefly we have discussed the comparison between different types of microcontroller. As you can see, there are different types of microcontrollers we have listed in a first column. There is a 8089S52, there is a ARM11 processor, there is a PIC microcontroller, there is a MCS251, there is ATMEGA8, there is LPC2138. Second column, basically we have shown the to which family these microcontroller belongs. So you can see that there are various companies are there, from Intel to ARM to Atmel to AVR. So different manufacturing companies are there, which are basically manufacturing the microcontrollers. Also you can see that there are the 8-bit microcontroller, there is a 32-bit microcontroller, and then also you can see that some of the microcontrollers are using Harvard architecture, some of are using von Neumann or Princeton architecture. But you can see that in totality, in most of the microcontroller uses Harvard architecture, because the execution time is very faster. If you are looking into the fourth column, which basically tells about which type of instruction set that particular microcontroller is using. So there is a CISC complex instruction set, and then reduced instruction set, and then finally the last column tells us the to which application we need to use these type of microcontrollers. So in totality, the applications are divided into two: low level data handling and then high level data handling. So for selecting a particular microcontroller, first we need to look into what task we would like to do, and then we need to find out what all the interfacing devices we require, like say how many sensors are required. For example, if you want to control the room temperature, so for that we need a temperature sensor, right? And then we need to interface that temperature sensor to the microcontroller. And then we need to look at the amount of data it is generating. So basically it boils down to the task which you want to carry out. So my suggestion to student is, let us Google it for some application. Say you can take an object, right? You can look into your home, and you can just design a either say room temperature controller or the automatic on and off of lights. So for these cases, what you can do is you can Google it for various types of data. You'll get everything in Google, and you can look into what type of microcontroller is best suited for that particular task. Because basically, if you are looking into the cost of the microcontroller nowadays, you are getting a microcontroller for 150 or 200 rupees also. But if you're looking at your seniors who are doing the project work, they are spending around 8,000-9,000 for a microcontroller based projects. But if you know the basics of microcontroller, if you know what you want to do, by googling it or by consulting your teachers, you can do the same project with a lesser amount of rupees. For example, the same 8,000, 9,000 project you can do in for 1,000 or 1,500. So this basically table compares different types of micro controllers. So this ends the module 1. So in module 1 we have started our discussion with basically the difference between microprocessor and then the microcontroller and then the embedded system. So we have started our discussion with some basics of computer, what is meant by CPU, what is meant by address lines, what is meant by data lines, what is meant by control bus, what is meant by program counter. Then we have discussed some important terminologies which are used in the computer, like what is meant by bit, what is meant by byte, what is meant by kilobyte, megabyte, gigabyte, and then terabyte. Then we have briefly discussed about the architecture of a microprocessor, wherein we have seen that there is a CPU, central processing unit, or in most of the cases it is known as what, simple processor. Then some peripherals which are connected to it, like maybe memory is connected to it, both ROM and then RAM. Then maybe monitor is interfaced to it, keyboard is interfaced to it, then timers are interfaced to it. Then we have gone into what is microcontroller. So there we have realized that what all the things which we have in microprocessor, everything is there on chip, then it becomes a microcontroller. Microprocessor is what we have, some discrete blocks, right, which are connected to the processor, whereas in case of microcontroller, all those components are there on the same chip, that becomes a microcontroller. Then we have compared the microprocessor and then the microcontroller. So I have shown with a table, so you can briefly look into these. Right, so you can see that microprocessor is a heart of a computer system, whereas microcontroller is a heart of a embedded system. As we have also studied what is meant by embedded system, we have defined embedded system as a device or a system which does a same work repeatedly, whereas computer will do so many works, so many diversified work, whereas embedded system will do a single task. So we have given many examples of embedded system, like in ATM machine or a washing machine, or a you can take an example of what a camera. You can give many examples where a device is doing only a particular task, whereas computer will do so many tasks. So there is one more comparison. Microprocessor is just a processor, right? So if you are looking at the figure, memory and IO components have to be connected externally. So there is a processor, and then a timer, memory, IO ports, serial interface, everything is connected external to the processor. Whereas if you are looking at the microcontroller, microcontroller doesn't have an external processor, right? So here everything is on chip. If you are looking at the block diagram, so there is a microcontroller, there is a timer, there is a IO port, there is a memory, right, there is a serial interface. Now everything is on chip, whereas in microprocessor there is a chip, and then everything is connected external to it. Then there is a one more comparison. Since memory and IO has to be connected externally, the circuit becomes large. Whereas in case of microcontroller, as everything is on chip, then circuit becomes small, and then cannot be used in compact system and hence inefficient. So as we need to interface all the required thing external to the processor, so in that case, for applications where we need compactness, then microprocessor becomes inefficient. Whereas if you are looking at microcontroller, as everything is there on chip, then it becomes an efficient technique or method. Now cost of microprocessor is more, whereas cost of microcontroller is low because everything is on chip. So all these things we can say as an advantages of microcontroller. Now there is one more conversion. Due to external components, the entire power consumption is high. Hence, it is not suitable to use with device running on stored power like batteries. So as most of the devices are connected externally, each device will require power supply. So the power consumptions will be more. Whereas in case of microcontroller, power consumptions will be less. And this can be used for the applications where they are being operated using batteries. Most of the microprocessors do not have power saving features, whereas microcontrollers have got power saving techniques. Since memory and I/O components are all external, each instruction will need external operation, hence it is relatively slower. For example, if you want to access some data from the memory, so processor has to generate the address. It needs to send that address on the address lines to the memory. It has to access the data and brings back it to processor and then process it. So it becomes a slower, whereas microcontroller is a faster. Then microprocessor have got less number of registers, hence more operations are memory based. Again, memory based means what? The operation gets slower, whereas microcontroller has got more number of registers comparing to the microprocessor. So the operations becomes faster. Microprocessors are based on von Neumann model architecture, where program and data are stored in the same memory model, whereas microcontroller depends on, most of the microcontrollers depends on Harvard architecture. There are some microcontrollers which basically uses Princeton architecture also, mainly used in personal computers, right? Used in, few examples are given as that it may be used in washing machine, MP3 player, and then so on. So basically, if you are looking at the comparison of microprocessor and microcontroller, mostly we have listed the advantages of microcontroller, but at the same time it has got disadvantages also. Then there are some salient features of 8051 microcontroller. We have discussed the architecture of 8051. Along with that architecture, we need to know about the features of 8051. So you can see that 8051 is an 8-bit microcontroller. So we have a 8-bit CPU. Then we have a on-chip clock oscillator. Then we have a 4 kilobytes of ROM. Then 128 bytes of RAM. And then if you require more amount of memory, then that can be interfaced to 8051, either ROM and then RAM, as we have discussed in the numericals. Then 64 kilobytes of external program memory address space, both ROM and RAM. So we can externally interface 64 kilobytes of ROM and 64 kilobytes of RAM. This is the maximum limit, because as we have discussed that the amount of memory depends on the number of address lines. That is, we are using that equation 2 to the power of n. So we have a 16 address lines, so 2 to the power of 16 will give you 64 kilobytes. So maximum we can interface is 64 kilobytes. Then we have 32 bidirectional I/O pins. We have 4 ports, port 0, port 1, port 2, port 3. Each port gives us 8 lines, so 8 into 4, 32 bidirectional input-output lines. Then we have two counters, two timers, T0 and then T1, 16-bit timers. Then full duplex serial data receiver transmitter is there. Then we have a 4 register banks, and each bank has got 8 registers, that is from R0 to R7. So totally we have 8 into 4, 32 registers along with accumulator and then B. Again, we have discussed how to select a register bank. So using program status word, 2 bits in program status word RS1 and then RS0, we can select a particular register bank, either bank 0, bank 1, bank 2 or bank 3. Then we have two 16-bit registers known as what, program counter and then the data pointer. Further, data pointer can be used as two 8-bit registers, DPH and then DPL. Again, we have discussed program counter. Basically, it points to the next instruction which is to be executed. Then we have a 8-bit program status word. So out of the 8 bits of program status word, 4 bits are used for conditional flags like carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, parity flag, and then overflow flag. 2 bits are used for selecting a register banks, and 2 bits are not used. And along with 8-bit program status word, we have a 8-bit stack pointer also. Basic function of stack pointer is to store or retrieve the data or address temporarily. So particularly we have studied two instructions, push and then the pop instructions, for storing and retrieving it. After push instruction, stack pointer will be incremented by 1, and stack pointer will be decremented by 1 once we use pop instruction. Then we have a interrupts also. There are 5 vector interrupts are there. So these are the some of the salient features of 8051. So there are a few questions from module 1. So you can look into the questions. The first question is, what with a neat block diagram explain the features of 8051 microcontroller. So features already we have discussed in the previous slides. There are various features of 8051, and then we need to draw the neat block diagram of 8051, and then we need to explain register A, register B, then a program status word, stack pointer, program counter, DPTR, then with respect to amount of RAM and ROM what we have, then with respect to special function registers. So one question is, what with a neat block diagram explain the features of 8051 microcontroller. Then with a neat functional block diagram explain the architecture of 8051. There are two blocks we have discussed under the architecture of 8051. So either one can be used. So again, for refreshing it, so this is what one of the block diagram of 8051 architecture, where of course everything is on chip, but we have a different blocks also. There is a CPU, there is an interrupt control, there is on chip ROM, on chip RAM, then timer, serial port, IO ports, bus control, oscillator, and then we have one more structure also. So you can see that there is a ALU, arithmetic and logical unit. So all these things are there in ALU, in CPU, sorry. So arithmetic and logical unit, register A, register B, program counter, DPTR, program status word, special function registers, then ROM, then 4 ports, port 0, port 1, port 2, port 3, along with latch, they are connected. And then you can have a look at RAM structure also. Right, so register bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, bank 3, and then byte and bit addresses. So this we have discussed. Then design a microcontroller system using 8051 with 4 kilobyte of ROM and 8 kilobyte of RAM interface, the external memory, such that the starting address of ROM is 1000H and RAM is C000H. So in detail we have discussed the 4 to 5 numericals, wherein we have discussed how to design a microcontroller where we want to interface a external memory to it, both ROM and RAM. So for a design aspect, we have discussed that first and foremost we should know how much amount of memory we want to interface, whether ROM and RAM. So in this case, we can see that we want to interface 4 kilobyte of ROM and then 8 kilobyte of RAM. So first, let us look into the designing of ROM. So we need to know the number of address lines required for ROM, 4 kilobyte of ROM. So using equation 2 to the power of n is equal to 4 kilobyte, so we will get n is equal to, which gives us the 4 kilobyte. So here n is the number of address lines. So once you get the number of address lines, those many address lines you need to keep it as n1, and remaining address lines we need to keep it as n0 for selecting ROM. And then we have the starting address of ROM is 1000, and then with 4 kilobyte we need to find out the end address of ROM. And again for calculating RAM, again size of RAM here is different, 8 kilobyte. So again use equation 2 to the power of n is equal to 8 kilobyte. So we'll get n is equal to some value, so that n again is the number of address lines required. So again from that we need to design the microcontroller interfacing. So just to revive it, so we can look into this problem. So here we are trying to interface 8 kilobyte of ROM and 8 kilobyte of RAM. So using equation 2 to the power of n is equal to 8k, so we'll get n is equal to 13. So address lines required are a0 to a12. So a13, a14 and a15, we have to make it as an 0 along with PSEN. So when low, the ROM is selected. So a13, a14, a15 and PSEN is given as an input to OR gate, and then output of OR gate is given to chip select. And similarly for RAM, again it is of 8 kilobytes, so again here we'll get n is equal to 13. So you can see that a0 to a12 are used for interfacing 8 kilobyte of RAM. Remaining address lines a13, a14, a15, we need to keep it as an high for selecting RAM. So these are given to NAND gate, and again which is given to chip select of RAM. So again we are trying to find out the starting address and then the end address. So in the given numerical, starting address is not mentioned, so default starting address is 0000, whether it is given. Okay, in this case starting address is given, so starting address we are taking as 000 for ROM, and then make 13 address line is equal to 1 and remaining 3 address lines as 0. So end address will get at is 1FFF for ROM, and for RAM also the starting address is given as E000. Then we'll have to find out the end address. So what we discussed is 13 address lines we need to keep it as 1, and remaining address lines 13, 14 and 15 we need to make them as 1 for selecting RAM. So end address will be FFFF. And then interfacing, right? So there is an 8051 IC. So you can see that as we discussed in the pin diagram of 8051, the data and address lines are used in a multiplexed format, AD0 to AD7. So here we are demultiplexing it. So D0 to D7 are the data lines. Using latch, we have demultiplexed it. So we have got A0 to A7 address lines, but we require 13 address lines. So remaining address lines from A18, A8 to A12 are taken from port 2. Then A13, 14 and 15 along with PSEN are given to OR gate, and that is given to chip select, and the same is given to read pin of ROM, as ROM indicates read only memory. So same output of OR gate is given to chip select and read. Coming to the interfacing of RAM, again as size of both ROM and RAM are same, 8 kilobyte. So D0 to D7, A0 to A7, then A8 to A12 are same, the connection remains same. If the size changes, then the connection will change. So A13, A14, A15 are given as an input to AND gate, and output of AND gate is given to chip select. Then write and read pin of 8051 are given as an is connected to the write and read pin of RAM. as RAM stands for random access memory for both reading and then writing. This is how we need to design a interfacing of 8051 with external memory. So this is a very important aspect of 8051 designing. So every student should know how to interface a given amount of ROM and given amount of RAM to 8051. Then one more important question from this module is, mention the internal RAM organization of 8051. We have discussed that there are 128 bytes are there. So those 128 bytes we have divided into three groups. For 32 bytes for register banks, bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, and then bank 3. Then for bit addressable, and then remaining bytes are used for as a scratch pad. So we need to know the internal memory organization, RAM organization of 8051. Then differentiate between microprocessor and microcontroller. Right. Little while ago, with a table, we have discussed the comparison between microprocessor and then the microcontroller. Then one more question. Sketch the knee diagram of 8051 pinout and explain ALE, RST, PSEN, and then RD pins. ALE stands for the address latch enable, programs storage enablers. Then show the interfacing connections of external EPROM and RAM to 8051. Again, here he is asking as a design question, wherein he has given the value of ROM and then the RAM. He has also given starting address of both ROM and RAM. Whereas here it is a theory question, right? Here he wants to know how to interface EPROM and RAM to 8051. So again, with some amount of ROM and some amount of RAM, we can explain how to interface external memory to 8051. Again, as we have discussed, don't get confused with EPROM here, right? So it is ROM and then RAM. As ROM comes with what PROM, which stands for programmable read-only memory. EPROM is what erasable programmable read-only memory. And then one more version is what EEPROM, which is electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. So whether it is ROM or PROM or EPROM, design aspects will remain same. Then one more important question from module 1 is what discuss program status word. So with a neat block diagram, we have discussed the program status word. We have discussed all the functions of 8 bits. And there are few questions, MCQ questions, multiple choice questions. Let us look into the questions and try to answer these simple questions. From the last 5 to 6 classes, we are discussing the what is meant by microprocessor, what is meant by microcontroller, what are the similarities, what are the differences between microprocessor and microcontroller, what is meant by embedded systems, what are the applications of embedded systems. And then we have discussed 8051 microcontroller in detail. So depending on them, we have few multiple choice questions. So look at the first question. First question is, 8051 series has how many 16-bit registers? So the options we have is 2, 3, 1, and then 0. That means either 8051 has got 2 16-bit registers or 3 16-bit registers or 1 16-bit registers, or we don't have any registers of 16-bit in 8051. So answer to this question, that everybody should be able to answer this. As even though 8051 is a 8-bit microcontroller and most of the registers in 8051 are 8-bit, like accumulator, like register B, program status word, then stack pointer, then registers in register banks, that is R0 to R7 are all of 8 bit, but there are two registers which are of 16 bit. Those are program counter and then the data pointer that we have discussed. So answer to this question, 8051 series has got two 16 bit registers, namely program counter. The function of program counter, as we have discussed, is to point to the next instruction which is to be executed next. And then data pointer is again 16 bit, but that can be used as 2 8-bit, DPH and then DPL. So answer is A. Then second question, when 8051 wakes up, then 0000 is loaded to which register? During the course of this module, we have discussed many times, whenever a 8051 wakes up, that means whenever you power up the 8051, what happens to registers, default registers? So answer to this question, whether it is DPTR or stack pointer or program counter or program status word. So DPTR is a 16-bit register, stack pointer is a 8-bit register, program counter is again 16-bit register, program status word is 8-bit registers. So if you are looking at the address, which is 16-bit address, so PSW and SP are ruled out because they are 8-bit. Then we have a DPTR and then the program counter of 16-bit. So as we have discussed that whenever a 8051 wakes up, the address 000 will be loaded into a program counter. One more question, when the microcontroller executes some arithmetic operations, then the flag bits of which registers are affected, whether it is program status word or stack pointer or data pointer or program counter. So question here asked is, whenever some operation is being taken place, whether it is addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, so flag bits of which register is affected. So there are different flags we have discussed, like a carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, parity flag, and then the overflow flag. So obviously the answer to this question is program status word. It is a 8-bit register. Of course, stack pointer is also 8-bit register, but its function is different. DPTR is 16-bit, PC is 16-bit, but their task is different. So program status word basically tells the status of the flags. Then how are the status of carry, auxiliary carry and parity flag affected if these two instructions are executed? So first instruction is move a comma hash of 9c. So once this instruction is executed, 9c will be copied into a, and then next instruction is what, add a with 64. So the task here being carried out is 9 stands for 10. So I would like to ask students to carry out this. 9 is 1001. Then we need to write equivalent of C also, which is 1100, and we need to add 64 to it. 6 in binary 0110, 4 is 0100. So add these two numbers. So we'll get 1. So we'll get the answer as 100. So if you are looking at the status of the flags, here there is a carry is being generated from the 8th bit. So carry flag is 1. Then there is a carry generated from D3 to D4, that means auxiliary carry is equal to 1. And then if you are looking at the number of 1s, all are zeros, so here parity is equal to 0. So carry flag is 1, auxiliary carry is 1, and then parity is equal to 0. That means answer to this question is B, where carry is 1, auxiliary carry is 1, and then parity is 0. So every student should be able to carry out a small exercise like this. In detail, in the module 2, we'll be discussing about the instructions. We'll be starting our discussion with what is meant by addressing mode and then different instructions. Then how are the bits of the register PSW affected if we select bank 2 of 8051? So during our discussion on program status word, we have discussed that out of 8 bits, 4 bits are used for conditional flags and 2 bits RS1 and then RS0 are used for selecting a bank. So if that RS1 and then RS0, if both are 0, 0, 0, bank 0 is selected, 0, 1, bank 1 is selected, 1, 0, bank 2 is selected, and then 1, 1, bank 3 is selected. So here question is, how are the bits of register PSW affected if you select bank 2? Bank 2 means for selecting a bank 2, we must have 1 and 0. RS1 should be 1 and then RS0 should be 0. So in that case, we need to look into the bit wise. So 5 4 2 3 1 4, so option D, if you are looking at option D, program status word bit 4 is 1 and program status word bit 3 is 0. So for this 1 0, bank 2 will be selected. So answer to this question is D. And then if you push data onto the stack, then the stack pointer, what happens to the stack pointer? So 4 options are given: increases with every push, decreases with every push, increases and decreases with every push, and then none of the above. So as we have discussed the stack pointer in detail and then how to operate the stack pointer using push instruction. So if you remember the explanation what we had for the stack pointer, after every push instruction the stack pointer will be incremented by 1. And we also discussed the reason for incrementing the stack pointer, because we need to have a increasing addresses, because the default address of stack pointer is 7. So every time we'll be starting with 8 address. So if you decrement it, we'll be having only the 7 addresses, 7, 6, 5, and then 4, 3, 2, 1. So always once we use the push instruction, stack pointer will be incremented by 1s. Then on power of, the 8051 uses which RAM location for register R0 to R7. Again, the question here is, what happens once you power up the 8051? What will be the default register RAM locations? So answer to this question, whether it is 00 to 2F, 00 to 07, 00 to 7F, or 00 to 0F. So you can see that R0 to R7 means what? We have 8 registers. But if you are looking at the options, 00 to 2F, obviously it is more than 8. Then 00 to 7F, again it is more than 8. 00 to 0F, again it is more than 8. So option left is what? 00 to 07, total 8 locations. So answer to this question is B. Then number of IO ports we have in 8051 microcontroller, whether we have 3 ports or 4 ports or 5 ports or 4 ports with last port having 5 pin. Repeatedly we have discussed that 8051 has got 4 IO ports: port 0, port 1, port 2, and then port 3. So answer to this question is B. then program counter stores what? So four options are given, whether it stores address of the before instruction, or it stores address of the next instruction, or it stores data of the before execution to be executed, or data of the execution instructions. So as we have discussed, that program counter basically stores the address of the next instruction which is to be executed. So if ALU is executing second instruction, program counter will be having the address of third instruction. So answer to this question is B. Then auxiliary carry is set during which condition? So in the discussion of program status word, we have discussed the condition of many flags like carry, auxiliary carry, parity and overflow flag. So in that we have discussed when the carry flag will be set. So options given are when carry is generated from D3 to D4, when carry is generated from D7, when carry is generated from D3 to D4 and D7, when carry is generated at either D3 to D7 or D7. So answer to this question is when a carry is generated from D3 to D4, then auxiliary carry flag will be set. And then one more question is external access pin, that is EA pin of 8051 is used to permit what, right? Whether it is used to permit peripherals or power supply or address latch enable or memory interfacing. So answer to this question is for interfacing memory. So if you want to interface external memory to 8051, then EA pin is used. Basically this EA pin permits us to interface the memory. So this is all about module 1. In the module 2 we will be discussing about what is meant by addressing modes. Basically addressing mode is defined as the way in which the operands or the data is being assigned. In the module 1, a few of the instructions we have discussed, like if you are looking at this instruction move a comma hash of 9c, here 9c is the data. So here 9c we are copying into a. So which addressing mode we are using here? So here we are using a hash sign. So this hash sign indicates it is immediate addressing mode, means what? 9c is a data that is directly copied into a. So there is an immediate addressing mode, there is a register addressing mode, register indirect addressing mode. So there are different addressing modes are there by which the data can be assigned. So we'll be starting our discussion of module 2 with addressing mode, different types of addressing modes. Then importantly, we'll be discussing about the instruction set of 8051. Basically, we need the instructions in order to write the program. Here instruction basically tells the processor what to do. For example, if you are looking at the these instructions, so move a comma hash of 9c, so here move indicates the operation to the processor. So once the processor looks at this instruction, move instruction, obviously this move will be converted into machine language, because either processor or controller will know only in terms of zeros and ones. So by looking at the move, that is opcode, operation code or the instruction, the controller will know what to do. So here by looking at this instruction, the controller knows that it has to transfer the data or it has to copy the data. Then this is destination and this is immediate data. And then if you're looking at the second instruction, add instruction, again the controller, when it looks at this instruction add, it knows that it has to add the data. So we have different types of instructions, and all the instructions of 8051 are classified into different groups, like data transfer instructions like move instruction, and then arithmetic instructions like add instruction, add with carry, subtract instruction, then logical instructions like AND, or then bit manipulation instructions. So in the module 2 we'll be discussing about all these instructions. Along with that we'll be trying to understand and trying to write small programs using 8051. Thank you.